All right, welcome. Let us start. So welcome to the lecture 18 of the machine learning course. We are going to talk about the clustering in this particular session. And one technique that we are going to focus on is the k-means. There will be other techniques also, but we are going to start with the k-means. So clustering is a very important task that we do into the computer science domain, machine learning domain. And what is the clustering? Actually, we want to group the data. If the data is given to you, you want to group the data based on their homogeneity. Means if the items are alike, you want to group, put them into one group. If other items are alike, then you put it into the another group. So out of all the items which are there, you say that looks like that these items are similar, these items are similar, these items are similar. And when you do this, this particular task is called as a clustering. Definitely, whenever you are going to say that these two items are into one group, then we are going to decide this based on some of the measure that we can call it, that is similarity and the closeness. So this group is called clusters. This group is technically called here cluster. So we are going to in essence, we are going to find out the clustering into the data. So let me give you an example so that it becomes clear to you. Let's assume that this is what the data is, where this point means that what is the X location, what is the Y location, and based on that, you can find out that this is what the they are actually put at that particular place, where let's assume that only two attributes are there, X and Y, and X is here, Y is here. I have plotted this into the area. You may be thinking that the two items, for example, this item and this item, which are actually looks like that they are near, so may be possible that they are similar. So the same idea we can apply over here and try to find out that how many different groups are there which are actually coherent. So how can you find out the solution for me, that how many clusters are there? So looks like that there is a large distance in distance into this particular area. So you can say that these items look like to be the similar and these items look like to be the similar. So this is the first approach for the clustering, where you say that these items are triangle and these items are square. You can say that looks like that these items are one kind and other items are the another kind. But if you know from your higher understanding that looks like that only two kind of items are not there, looks like there are four kind of items. And if I ask you that, can you discover that? So maybe you can come up with another clustering strategy, C2, where you say that looks like that these items are the similar kind, these items are the similar kind, these items are the similar kind, and these items are the similar kind. How many clusters you have produced? You have produced four clusters. You have produced four clusters. If I say that no, looks like that I have six clusters, then you would go for the another strategy. You can again try to find out the similarity, and then you can tell that looks like that these items are one kind, the another kind, another kind, these are star, these are squares, these are the tilted squares. So you can find out, you can say that looks like that these six kind different kind of things are there. So in this particular example, you should be able to appreciate that if it depends upon the requirement. If I say that that looks like that there are two different kind of things are there, then you come up with this kind of strategy. If you know about the data, then you can tell that this is the right cluster. If you further know about the data, then you can say that this is the clusters. So there is some inherent understanding, maybe that I say that bias, that into the machine learning domain, we say this particular thing as a bias, that if the bias is there, then you can tweak the learning and you can tell that what are the appropriate clusters, what are the items, how many clusters are there, then what is their what is the appropriate membership of each of the items into the clusters. So objective is here, our objective, what is our objective? Our objective is that if we form a group, then the item should be related and they should be different from the object of the other group. For example, if I say that this item and this item, so they should be in their group, they should be similar. But if I compare this group and this group, they should be different. So when we do this, when can we tell that it is better? For example, here multiple clustering, we have seen that C1 clustering, C2 clustering, C3 clustering. Which clustering is better? C1 is better, C2 is better, or C3 is better? Very important question that we would like to understand when we would go ahead with the lecture. Okay. Any questions till now? Let me see that there is something written. Okay. So clustering approaches can be divided into various different kind of approaches. So one approach says that you want to find out well-separated clusters. Well-separated cluster means let's assume that these items which are here, they are into one cluster, items which are here, they are into the different cluster. Now we have two clusters, they are well-separated. Another approach could be center-based clustering, where I say that this is the item and this is the item, these are the centers, and the items which are here, they are actually of the same kind. Therefore, if I give any particular point, you can tell that which item belongs to which particular cluster. One more interesting approach says that continuity-based clusters. So continuity-based cluster means looks like that there are some points and you can connect them. You tell that these are the one cluster type. These items which are actually here, you say that they are into the second cluster. These items which are here, you say that they are into the third cluster, and you say that there is a connection. So all these items are actually into the third cluster. So this is the another cluster. So how many clusters are here? Three clusters. Okay. So this is continuity-based clustering. Another interesting idea says that you can find out density-based clustering of the items. So if, for example, you can see that here more items are there into the unit area. So you can say that looks like that these items are of the one kind. Here the less dense area is there. So you say that this is the second clustering. And here very sparse things are there. You can say that this is the third area. Okay. So it is a density-based clustering. Most of the time you can see that when some clinical kind of observation is there, medical domain, you want to find out something, want to segregate some portion of the tissues from the other, you can apply these kind of clustering over here, there. Another interesting idea is this, that we talk about the conceptual clustering. Conceptual clustering means we want to give some concept, and based on that, we want to find out that what are the items belonging to which particular cluster. For example, if the concept is geometry, then we can say that the items are either triangle or the rectangle or the squares or the circles. And then you say that looks like that these items are of the first kind, these and they are going to be of the different kind. So how many clusters are there? Two clusters are there, because here I have put a concept that looks like the items are of this particular kind only. The groups are of this particular kind only. So we can divide this into this part. Here comes an interesting idea that tells that looks like that these items are of the one kind and these items are of the another kind. Okay, you can see that here that there are few portions such as this particular portion, the items which are actually here, they belong to both the groups. It can also be possible that one item can belong to both the group. Okay, is it possible? Okay, it is possible. For example, if I create multiple groups of the students in my college, I can say that how many groups, let's assume that I create one kind of group, for example, people playing football, people playing badminton. So it may be possible that you belong to two different groups. So there could be possibility that few items are there which are actually belonging to both of the things. Very interesting idea, where sometimes we want to associate a probability over here. What is the probability that they are going to belong to this particular thing? So this thing is called a fuzzy. There is a very interesting name called the fuzzy membership of the items. So clustering is a unsupervised activity, as we have seen just now, that when the items are given, what do you mean by unsupervised? That when the items are given, you are not told that what is their groups. For the given item, it is not told that this which particular group this particular item belongs to. You have to create some group and then you have to assign this particular item to that particular group. So that's why it is unsupervised. Right answers are not provided. Right answer for any of the items is not provided. So clustering is very useful in summarization, because if you know the clustering thing, then you can find out a representative. For example, this was the data. Lot of the data items were, let's assume the lot of the data items are here and here, and you want to find out the representative. You can say that looks like that we have how many clusters? 2 clusters. So if you can discover 2 clusters, you can say that this centroid may represent this particular data. This centroid may represent this particular data. And then you say that forget about all the things. These things are not there. We are assuming that these things are not there. Only these centroids are there, and therefore they are going to represent the data. All the data items, you can think that they are not there. Only these representative are there. And therefore, using them, you can actually describe the data. It's a kind of summarization that you can tell that we have summarized the data. You can do the data compression, because if you have summarized, means lot of data you have represented with the small number of items. So you could, it is a compression. Sometimes this kind of method can also be useful into finding out the nearest neighbors. What is the nearest neighbor? So you know that sometime into the, for example, this is what the space is. And you know that into the, when we are talking about k nearest neighbor algorithm. So when a new point was coming, we have to find out that which, for example, k different nearest point we need to discover. This is not an easy task. We have seen that it is very difficult to find out the different thing, because if a database is given to you, for this particular item need to be compared with all the items over here and see that what is their scores, and then find out that which are the top 3 minimum values. If k is equal to 3, which are the top 3 minimum values. Okay, so finding out this thing requires a lot of hard work. If the data size, number of data items in your database is mod d, then mod d number of comparisons are needed. Very difficult to do. So if you can do some kind of aggregations, and you say that looks like that this is what the areas are. Okay, and one method could be that you say that you divide all this, for example, you divide all this space into this way, you divide into this way, and put all these items into some tree structures. So what may happen that whenever a new item is coming, you access this particular area only, you just get access of only these many items and try to search this item into this particular place. And into the tree, you maintain some kind of digest over there. So you can apply this method to efficiently find out the nearest neighbor, because now you can see that using digest and using some of the specialized techniques, you can improve this particular searching process. And now you need not to search through the complete database. You only have to search for the small portion of the databases, and your answer would be there. If you do the clustering, it could be of various kinds. One is the hierarchical versus partitional. What is the hierarchical? You know that as just a few minutes back we have talked about that from very high level perspective, you think that all the items are there. Then you divide the thing into 2 parts. This is the first part, this is the second part. You divide into this way. Then it further divide, you say that into the tree, you say that in this particular portion. You can say that further divide the thing, you say that I'm going to consider this particular part, I'm going to consider this particular part. Here you can say that I'm going to consider this particular part. Here you can say that I'm going to consider this particular part. Further you divide these things. So it could be hierarchical. Okay. Another could be partitional. Partitional means you divide the items into the sets. Okay. You divide the item into sets. So if you are getting any kind of confusion here, let me say you into this particular way, that there is a method called S-link. What it does, that it try to links the items which are nearer. Let me give you an example. So let me give you an example. Okay. So hierarchical, partitionally, you understood that we partition complete area. Hierarchical means, let's assume that this is the data point, 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 this is the data point. For example, this is the data point, okay? 5 data points I have. So can you tell me that if this is my data point, then who are the 2 nearest points? If I say that this is 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4, 0.5. So looks like that these two points are nearer. So what I would do that instead of this thing, I would put another point. I would put another point in my database. That is not the another point. I say that they are one into one cluster. Make sense? Then which two points are nearer? Looks like that these two points are nearer. So this is the second cluster. So how many clusters we have? Initially, I had five clusters because five items were there. They all were different. So from the five cluster, I moved to the four clusters. When I combined these two items, then again, if I combine these items, I get three clusters. Okay. So from this, I have three clusters. Can I get the two clusters? To find out the two cluster, find out the two points which are actually near it. Looks like that this distance, and this distance, only this thing you can compare. So which is the lowest distance? I think the lowest distance is minimum distance is this. So you can say that I'm going to combine these things once again. So how many clusters you have? Now you have two clusters. So can you recognize them? The first cluster is this, and another cluster is this. These are the two clusters. And now from above, if you again want to go and want to tell me that you want to get only one cluster, then how you have to go ahead? There is no other way. You have to combine these two things. So from very high level, you say that there is one cluster. Then in one cluster, there is item 1, 2. In here you say that 3, 4, and 5. Items are 3, 4, 5. If you further divide, they becomes 1 and 2. Here you define they become 5 and 3, 4. Further divide, they becomes 3 and 4. So this is how the hierarchy of the items. Understand? So hierarchical versus partitional, we have just seen that hierarchical versus partitional, and there could be exclusive versus overlapping versus fuzzy. 1 minute. Three things. What are the three things? Exclusive versus overlapping over fuzzy. Exclusive means when there are points, you every point you are going to say that what is the membership. This is of the cluster 1, this is into the cluster 2, this is into the cluster 3. This is what the exclusive membership. Overlapping means that you are telling that looks like that there are two clusters. So these items are into the cluster 1 and these items are into the cluster 2, but these items are into both. So it is an overlapping region where you for these points you say that they are into both the clusters. So this is overlapping. Okay. What is fuzzy? Fuzzy is something that tells that there are items, and there is you assign a probability that it is going to be into the one, probability that it is going to be into, for example, 0.3, 0.7, and 0.3. Let's assume that we have two clusters. The probability that this particular item belongs to the first one is 0.7, and probability that it belongs to the second one, it is 0.3. So these kind of thing you can be witnessing when you are going into the medical domain. There is some tissue you want to do some kind of segmentation. You are not sure whether this item is of them is a neuron or this is the white matter portion, what it is. So definitely what are gray matter item, what is that particular thing? Differently, you say that looks like that with the very high probability this seems to be a neuron, but I have not 100%, I'm not 100% sure. So there is associated probability with respect to that. If you have any question, please ask. So if you want to understand the basic nature of the clustering, it is unsupervised, as we have just few minutes talk about that. And then we have seen that. You can utilize this for the summarization. You can utilize this for the summarization, compression, and the efficiently finding nearest neighbors, etc. You can divide it into the hierarchical or partitional, exclusive, overlapping, fuzzy. Another important thing is that it could be a complete versus partial. Complete versus partial means if the data items are given to you and I ask you that can you do the clustering for me, looks like that the items are like this. Okay, see that looks like the items are like this. So can you tell me that how many clusters are there? Anybody, can you try? Looks like that one cluster is here, And this is looks like that another clusters. How many clusters are there? Can you tell me? Two clusters, or we can say that this is the one item, this is one cluster, and this is this item should also be included into here or not. I don't know, that looks like that this is a cluster, but whether should I include this item here or not. So sometime these kind of scenarios arises, and therefore we can say that looks like that these things are very bad. These things are looks like that they are noise, they are not the data item. You can tell that looks like that few things are noise, and you need not to do any clustering on this. Clustering is can only be done on these particular item. Looks like that other points are noise. If you somehow figure out that looks like that they are not good items, and you don't do the clustering on this, and you only apply clustering on some of the item, you say that you are actually applying the clustering into the partial thing. Now you understand complete and partial. Into the complete, all the data item, for all the data items you are going to do the clustering, and therefore you would be telling that one cluster and second cluster. But in some scenario it may not be a good idea. Therefore you go for the partial kind of clustering, where you say that looks like that here is a cluster, for but other places I don't see that there is any cluster. Understand the idea? Any questions on that, Miloni? This part is clear, complete and partial. Okay, now let us talk about the k-means, and this is one clustering algorithm that we are going to see in this particular class. So it is a prototype based means there would be some representative of the data, and we want to assign for all the data items that this item is of this particular kind type. So there is some prototype. So in our space, lot of data items are there, and there is also some prototype. I say that these are the prototype. So I would assign each the data item, like looks like that this item is of this particular kind, this item is of this particular kind, and therefore this every item is attached to its prototype. So it's a prototype based. Okay, it is partitional clustering, means it divides the thing into parts, and you say that these are items which are into one part, they are into one cluster, and another things are into the different clustering. Attempts to find a user specified number of clusters. User specified a value k, and those many clusters are actually discovered, which are represented by their centroid. Centroid represent the prototype. What is the prototype? This is going to be represented by this centroid. So we would see this algorithm into the detail. Object is the okay, this is nothing more than this, that we want to say that when we want to do the clustering, the prototype, the items should be near to the prototype. Okay, so let us see this algorithm, how this algorithm works. So here you should note first thing that into the k-means algorithm, you have to provide, the user have to provide, the person who is asking for this on the data, he provide the data plus the value of k. These two things he have to supply. This is what the algorithm is, and please focus on this. So let me tell you first using an example, so how this algorithm goes. So as I told you that let's assume that the data items are there. Let me put some data items over here. Data items are here. Let's assume that few data items are here. Okay. So this k-means algorithm is a prototype based. Focus here. So I would randomly pick some prototype. For example, I put the random prototype here. I picked a prototype here. I have randomly picked a prototype. Then what would I do? I would assign the item to its prototype. For example, because this item is nearer to here, this item is assigned to this prototype. This item is assigned to here. This item is nearer to here. So these items are actually assigned to this prototype. Every item is assigned to a particular prototype. After assigning this prototype, we actually understand that these items are assigned to the first prototype and these items are assigned to the second prototype. Then we forget about the prototype. Whatever the prototype was there, I forget about that. And use only these items to find out, use only these items to find out where is the centroid. You know that if centroid is the summation, if you want to find out the centroid of items, it is the summation of x divided by n number of item, summation of y divided by number of item. So you can find out where the centroid of all these items, centroid of all these items. Looks like that centroid would be somewhere here. So let me put another point over here. Similarly, for these points, where would be the centroid? Looks like that centroid would be somewhere here. So I would again put a point over here. It is a centroid point. Okay. So 1 minute, let me put the centroid with the red color. So centroid is here and centroid is here. Looks like that centroid is here. Okay. Again, I would have to repeat the same process. I have to assign this thing because based on the nearness, I would assign these points over here. So looks like that. This is the assignment. If this is the assignment, then again, if after this assignment, what would you do? You would again find out that what is the, looks like that this time, this is what my items are. Again, I would find out that what is the new centroid. New centroid would be here. New centroid would be here. Okay. So if there is a shift in terms of the centroid, then you keep doing this until after some time, what would happen? That this centroid would not, you can see that earlier centroid was here, now it came here. Initially it was here, it came to this particular point. If there is a shift, you keep doing it and after some time you can stop. Okay, so what we have seen that randomly select the K points at a centroid. Initially we have randomly picked this particular location and this particular location. Initially we have picked the random locations here and here. So algorithm says that randomly pick the K points as a centroid. Then for each the data item, what we have did, we have assigned this to one of the closest centroids. So you have seen that we have drawn a line and we tried to connect this with this thing, that which particular thing is nearer. And then after that, what we did, recompute the centroid mean of each cluster. So we have recomputed. And if there is no convergence, you do this until there is a convergence. Convergence means when you compute this cluster, this centroid once again, this value should be same. It should not shift much. If it is not shifting much, we are telling that looks like that this is the place where these cluster centers are. So how to find out that whether two points are close? This is an important point. How to find out that whether which particular centroid is near to me? Closeness is measured by the Euclidean distance. You can apply the Euclidean distance, cosine similarity, correlation, some divergence, other whatever method you wish you can apply. And depending upon your domain in which you are going to apply, some are going to be better than the others. Here is an example. Where this is run on a live example. So here, don't think about that. What are the red and green and blue points? Assume that these were the points. And randomly, let somebody gives you this, and this as a centroid point. So if these are the centroid points, so all the points here, they would be nearer to this. Here, they would be nearer to this. Here also, I can draw a line. Here also, I can draw a line between them. So looks like that these points are going to be to the one centroid, these to the second centroid, these to the third centroid. Okay, so when these are the items into the one cluster. So if these were the items and you want to find out that what is the centroid, looks like that the centroid would be somewhere here. So you can see that centroid has shifted. Same thing has been done here also. For these items, centroid would be here. So you can see that centroid is here. For these items, centroid is here. I think it would remain at the same place. So centroid from here to, it has shifted to this particular place. From here, it has shifted here. Again, you do the same thing. You find out these points are nearer. These points are nearer. These points are nearer. Again, you find out the centroid. You can see that centroid for this point would be somewhere here. Centroid for this point would be somewhere here. This point is actually shifting again here and here. Again, you find out for these places, these points are nearer, these points are nearer. Centroid of these points would be somewhere here. You can see that centroid is shifted here, centroid is shifted here. After some time, you would get converse, and this way you can find out that what are the cluster items. Any questions on this? Everybody is clear? Shashwat? Yes? How can you say that how good this particular clustering is? If you want to evaluate, because you have given me some set S1, S2, S dot dot SK, K sets you have given, and you are telling that this is the first group where what is the output? What is the output of the K means? You are going to give me few sets, and you are and that actually represent groups that looks like that point one is here. Point 3 is here, point 4 is here, point 2 is here, point 8 is here. So you got to be telling that which are the points which are inside this particular data points which are here. Instead of point, you can also write EX. Okay, you can say that first let's assume that these n data points are given. The task of K means is to give you the sets, K sets, every set which are the items are there. This part is clear? Everybody, this part is clear? The task of the K-means algorithm is what? Task of the K-means algorithm is what? That it is going to give you K sets, and those sets are going to have the objects. And how come this particular thing is going, for example, let me just write that S1 set, S2 set, S3 set, dot, 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 SK, K sets are there, and it contains some item. I'm not sure, some X are there such that X belongs to S1. Let me write like this. Similarly, I can define over here. So if these are the items, everybody concentrate, if these are the item into the S1, can I find out where is their centroid? Mu, let me say that I find out mu1, that is where is the centroid of these points, where is the centroid of these points, where is centroid of this kth point. Understand, I want to find out where is their centroid, and what is the how can I find out the centroid? Again, it is a summation of x divided by n, summation of y divided by n, dot dot dot, all the dimension I'm going to do that. So if I want to find out what is the distance of this point with the points into this particular set, and what is the distance of this point which is into S2 with this, it would be higher as compared to if I find out the distance of this point with this mu2, it would be smaller. So can I find out what is the distance of this item with this item? Yes, you can find out. Let me write a function. What is the distance of x with respect to the mu i, ith item? So I square this particular term, and I say that I find out summation for all x which are there into Si. So this is the distance of every point into the S1 with what? With their centroid. And here similarly I can do this also. I can put one more summation for I is equal to 1 to k for all the k's item. I can find out this particular summation. So can you understand that this value should be larger or smaller? Can you tell me whether I want this value to be larger or smaller? This value should be larger or smaller? Larger? I want this value to be larger. Sanidhya? Dipanshu? Athar? Small? This value should be small because if the mu is rightly selected, then all these distances are going to be small. So I can put a very strange kind of condition that is not very easy. This particular formula is same here. Let me cut it. This formula is same written over here. Here I am going to say that I want to find out that particular S, that particular division which minimizes this quantity. Okay, this minimizes this quantity. So this is what the mathematical representation of the K means. You know that mu correspond to the number of items over there, summation of the x, etc. So choice of a distance function is Euclidean distance, whatever you can use that. So this is, if you want to say that how to find out how to mathematically represent the K means, so this is how you represent mathematically the K means algorithm. It is the trying to find out that particular partition which minimizes this particular quantity. That's it. Now you may be asking, sir, okay, that is fine, but how can I find out the appropriate value of K? Because I need the value of K. Because if I don't know the value, two things I have to supply. With the database, I also have to supply the value of K. How can I know that what is the right value of K? There are a few suggestions. One suggestion says that run the K-means algorithm multiple number of time, okay, with the different values of K. So what do I mean by this? Let's assume that when the K is equal to 1, let's assume that when K is equal to 1, you execute the algorithm. You get this particular error, okay, this particular distance value. If you again run the algorithm, you may get some different value because randomly you are initializing, na? You are randomly initializing the thing, so sometime it reaches here, sometime if you initialize at the different point, the first point when it is first centroid when it is initialized, so it may not reach to the same point, so the value would be different. So the value would be different if multiple time you run, may looks like that these are the values you are going to get. When you increase the value of k is equal to 2, you may be getting these values. You increase the value of k, you may be getting these values. You increase the value of k, you may be getting these values. 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 Multiple times you are executing and you are putting this over here. Then you can very safely draw a line over here. You can say that looks like that. This is what the behavior of the things are when I'm going to increase the value of k. This particular graph has a very special kind of characteristics. If you visualize that, you can see that here is a sharp decrease into the value, but here the decrease is not that particular sharp. Okay, so but if you analyze this, you can see that there is a point, you can find out that there is a point where you can find out that looks like that is an elbow. Okay, the method is called elbow method. That looks like that it is an elbow. So you can draw a line and you can find out, choose the appropriate value of k from this particular place. You say that I'm going to use this particular value. Make sense? So the one value, one method, that where you are running the k-means algorithm multiple number of time and with the different values of k, and then you are applying elbow method to find out what is the best value for you, what is the appropriate value for you. Okay. So if you know that if the value of k is equal to n, then there would be no error, because you know that in your database, how many points are there? Let's assume n points are there. And if you have n number of centroid also, then definitely every centroid would be at the data point only. So you would have no error. But this is not the thing we want. We want that the k should be smaller, very smaller than as compared to the n. So a good clustering method have the smaller value of n. This is just we have talked about, that you find out that what is this particular quantity for every execution, and then you apply elbow method to find out that what is the appropriate value. Okay, so once again, that we have talked about, that if you want to choose the value of k, you can apply, sometime you can apply the domain knowledge also, because sometimes you know that these kind of items are only there. For example, most of the time it's a clustering problem. Clustering problem correspond to some kind of classification thing. So you know that people are either having affected by the COVID or not affected by the COVID, like that. So if you want to find out the vitals of the people, let's assume that you have vitals of the people and then now you want to segregate into the different groups. You know that how many groups are there. So if these kind of domain knowledge is available to you, you can apply those domain knowledge to say that looks like that these different items are there. Discover that for me. Another method could be that you can pre-process with the other algorithm. You can apply some other clustering algorithm to find out what is the value of k, and then you can to discover that what is the right value, right membership of the item, you can apply this particular method to find out that which item belongs to which particular category, which particular group or clusters. So, and the third method we have discussed, that iteration of the k will run multiple time. Again, there is one important question, that how you can initialize the centers. Sorry. A lot of data items are there. You want to initialize the center, for example, so would you be putting the centers would you be putting the centers here and here and start? Are you be putting here and here and start? Are you be putting here and here and start? Where would you putting? Here and here you would be putting? Where would you putting these two centers, cluster centers initially? So one idea that you can definitely guess that you can use the random points into the space, as I was mentioning. Another approach could be that you use random points of the data instead, because I was telling that in this particular space you are going to pick anything. But another approach could be that you pick some data items. For example, these are the data items. You randomly pick. You are actually 1 minute. Let's assume that these are the data points, and you randomly pick this particular place or this particular place. They are not allowed. You randomly pick a data point. For example, I pick this particular data item and pick this particular data item. They are going to be the starting point. Then after that, you execute the algorithm. Make sense? Instead of the first method was random point in the space. Second was random points on the data. Third is look for the dense region. Find out the where the dense, more dense area is. Apply this over there. Next method that you, whenever you select the first point, try to put the second point such that all the points are, for example, you divide the space into the parts and you say that all the points are here. Points which are actually going to start, they are here into the space. So spice, you divide the space into the k different parts and equally part, and then you put one point at the place. However, very interesting method where the most of the people are using these days is called the k-means plus plus. What is that? K-means plus plus. Okay, k-means plus plus. What is the k-means plus plus? It says that in your space, you pick first point anywhere. For example, I pick the first point here. Okay, then where would you pick the second point? The second point, if it is here, second point could be anywhere. Just consider this any particular line. Probability that this point is going to be here, they are defined. Now, if the largest, this point is going to have the largest, highest probability that the next point would be here. So you are dividing the space in such a way that there is a probability distribution over here with respect to the first point that you have chosen. And you say that the point which is actually farthest has a highest probability. So whether you'll be selecting this point, answer is no, because again, you are speaking the randomly. This point has a lesser probability. This point has a higher probability, highest probability. So most probably you'd be selecting this point, but since it's a random experiment, you may choose this point also. And when you choose two points, then again, you have to define all the space. And again, you find out into the complete space that the point which are the furthest to these two, they are going to have the higher probability to be being selected. Again, you do the sampling from this particular space, and by this you select the center points. This is called the k-means plus plus. Sometimes you want to find out that how group clustering have. We have just few minutes back that if you are going to have the good clustering, then you want to see that if it is a good clustering, then this diameter should be smaller. Okay. Diameter of the cluster versus intercluster distance. What is the intercluster distance? If these are the two clusters, what is the distance between these two clusters? So this intercluster distance should be high, and this particular portion should be small. Okay, this cluster should be smaller, but their distance between two clusters should be larger. Okay. Again, another method, that distance between the members of a cluster and the cluster center. So if you have a cluster and a cluster has a center here, data points are here, it is a good cluster. Or if I have from the cluster center, if the points are here, which one is better? I think the second one is going to be the better, where the points are nearer. Okay. Diameter of the smallest sphere, because multiple your things dividing the things into the terms of the spheres looks like spheres, but so the diameter of the smallest sphere, you can also utilize the as a matrix. So as I told you that there you should also know this particular point. For example, if these are the cluster centers, then I can draw a line here. For example, in both the two things, I can connect them. I can draw a line into this particular way, and I say that any point which is actually here, it is going to be near to this point. Any point which are here, they are going to be near to this particular point. Similarly, every pair of item I can draw a line. Every pair of the items I can draw a line. Every pair of the things I can draw a line, and I can tell that looks like that. This is the area for this thing. And then this is this is the area for this particular thing. And similarly there would be some area like this for this third one. Okay. And I can say that this is the area for the fourth one. So this is the region that it divides. Okay. K-means divides the region into this particular way. It is called what? V-O-R-N-O-I, Voronoi regions. It is called Voronoi regions. Make sense? So however, they are not circular, but they create Voronoi regions. Okay. Efficiency is an important factor, because you know that if you want to do it more effectively, mini batch, sometimes people talk about the mini batch k-means, where you are actually having the smaller number of items and you apply k-means on that, and then you induct the later items into the space. There are few problems also with the k-means algorithm, and let me talk about that. Limitation of the k-means algorithm. What is the limitation of the k-means algorithm? So you can see that this particular example. So can you tell me that how many clusters are there? Can anybody tell how many clusters are there? Atharv, three clusters are there. But the point that I'm going to make is very important. What is this? That I can carefully select a point, midpoint over here. And then if I select two points here and here, what would happen? That it would be divided into two parts. This is the first cluster, this is the second cluster, and they are going to be to the third cluster. You can see that it has happened over here. This is the first cluster, this is the second cluster, this is the third cluster. I have asked for the three clusters, but clusters are given in this particular way. Is it a right way? The answer is no. So k-means have a problem when the data has a different size of clusters, because we are going to think that here you can see that a smaller size, bigger size, then sometimes this particular algorithm has a problem. Different densities, if the densities are different, then also it has a problem. Non-globular shape. So actually what happens, that it assumes everything to be circular, or because convexity, actually we can tell that in that way, that algorithm assumes that there is a convexity. Let's assume that these items are into one cluster, but inside items are not into that particular cluster, then I would face serious problem. For example, if there are some items like this, then I would face serious problems. Okay. So this kind of clustering cannot be done using the k-means, because convexity means if there is a point and there is a point, if I combine them, to all the points in between, they should also be inside this particular cluster only. But they are not inside the cluster, so we have a problem. So when there is a non-global shape, then we have a problem. Handling of empty clusters sometime is actually not possible here, because if you think that there is a cluster that does not have any particular item, so it is not possible. You may be thinking, sir, why I need a cluster having no item? But sometime it may be possible that you are going to have a clustering. For example, you have a data, and this data is changing. Sometime more data is coming, and sometime some data items are actually removing. So when you do the clustering, you actually have understood that there is some concept available over here. But after some time, let's assume that the data points corresponding to this particular thing has gone. So that particular cluster would vanish. But what would happen to that particular concept that you have learned? The concept may be valid till now, because at later point of time, it may be possible that those points can come. Those points belonging to that particular set may come. Then you cannot represent those things when the item are not there. When the item would be there, then you can represent. But sometime when the items are not there, then you cannot represent those kind of concepts into the space. So empty clusters, you cannot represent. Outlier has a serious problem with this k-means algorithm. For example, if there is a some point here and here, they can seriously mislead the algorithm. And therefore, these things would not here, they would become come here, these points would come here. And they, therefore, the representative would not be representing the thing into the right way. Make sense? So these are the, some of the problems. Also, one important problem that if you want to update the centroids incrementally, it is not possible. What do I mean by this? For example, if you have a data and you have find out that these are the clusters that I have, few more points are coming to you, few more points are coming to you. Can you modify this structure to include them also? Answer is no, because then for all the data item, you have to run the algorithm once again. And this may take longer, very large time, if the data size is very large. A small caution here that sometimes people talk about this, what is k-means and what is knn. K-means and knn, because of this value k, seems to be the same, but it is a very confusing term. K-nearest neighbor is used for what? Can you tell me? We have seen earlier, it is a supervised approach for the classification. It is a supervised approach for the classification. K-nearest neighbor is just classification algorithm. In this particular session, we are going to call the k-means, that is a clustering algorithm. So the approach, these, however, the name is same because of the k-means and knn. They are totally different algorithm and they are used for the different purposes. One is used for the classification, another is for clustering. So it is a very important interview question most of the time asked. That's why I thought that I should put it to you. Other approaches such as mini batch k-means, less computations and the faster convergence. K-mediates, it says that instead of because I was telling that medium points, the points which are actually centroid points, they are actually into the space, but k-mediates says that you pick the points, data points only, and if you come up with the centroid as this particular, for example, when you compute the new centroid, it comes out to be here. So find out the nearest data point and you say that this is the point that I would be using for next. Okay, this method is called the k-mediates and it's an interesting idea. Agglomerative clustering, hierarchical clustering, we have few minutes before seen that. If the even 2, 3, 4 items are there, you find out which are the minimum nearest item. Then since these two points are nearer, then I combine them. Then I combine them into the thing, and this way I can find out this kind of clustering. It is called the single link clustering algorithm. Again, once again, all the data points are there. One by one, I'm going to combine based on the distance between the pair of the item. I'm not going to put any kind of consolidation over here. So all the data points are still intact, and only based on the distance, I'm going to combine them. Another very interesting algorithm is called the DBSCAN, density-based clustering algorithm. And there are more variation on this that is called affinity propagation, mean safety spectral clustering, hierarchical, optical, Gaussian mixture, BIRCS. So you can just see this just for the sake of curiosity, you can see all these things. DBSCAN is an interesting algorithm that actually has appeared into the KDD in 1996, very interesting algorithm. This algorithm has the two important points called the EPS and mean PTS, these two parameters. And using this, it divides all the data points into the core, border, and noise points. For example, if the data items are there, it sees that into this particular radius or EPS radius, how many min points are there. If the min points, number of points are there, then I say that it is a core point. If these many points are not there and the point is inside a core, near to the core point, it is called the border point. All other points are called the noise point. And using this kind of strategy, it actually applies a DFS to find out a clusters, to discover the cluster. So noise points are actually not going to be given any kind of clustering. So it is very easy to find out that looks like that this is one cluster, this is second cluster, and all other points are not clustered. However, this method is sensitive to the parameters. If you find out the right kind of parameter, you can discover the right kind of clustering. Advantage that it can give you the arbitrary shape clusters. It can handle the dynamic databases also. For example, dynamic databases, let's assume that this is what the clustering you have. This is the first cluster, second cluster, third cluster. One more point comes to you. So this point is very near. Nearby, there is no point. So this point becomes noise and there is no need to do anything. If this is a point and it needs a EPS neighborhood, it has a sufficient number of points available, then you create a new cluster. A point is coming over here, then it gets absorbed into the previously created things. If the point is coming here in between, if you see two different points, then it can merge and tell that two clusters becomes one cluster. So incrementally, you can go ahead this. So here right now, how many clusters we have? One cluster, two cluster, this is a noise point. If this point is deleted, there is no problem. If this point is deleted, then this cluster is deleted. If this point is deleted, then the complete cluster is split into two parts. If this point is deleted, no problem. We have actually this cluster and this cluster. So by this, DBSCAN can allow you to do the clustering into the database. You have a database, you are adding more item to that. And for example, delta plus item and delta minus item you are adding. So whatever results you have, you can find out the new result by investing only delta plus delta minus amount of computation. You need not to go and onto a complete database, you have to again find out the result. You only by just processing that item, as we have just discussed a few minutes back, you can find out that what is the right clustering for that. You need not to go onto the complete database. So this is what the very important part of this particular thing. Even the things are added or deleted from the database, even if the things are delta plus or delta minus added or deleted, you can find out that what is the result, what is the clustering onto the new database. So very interesting algorithm. That's all for my side today. Thank you very much.